from Kansas State University. This is Agriculture Today. Eric Atkinson here. Here's what's ahead. Checking in with this week's cattle market segment, Oklahoma State University's Darrell Peel. Among other things, Darrell will talk about domestic beef demand trends heading into the Christmas holiday season. Then, from K-State's livestock judging team, Coach Chris Mullenix, and team members Chisholm Grund and Trace Mulligan will talk about the team capturing the 2020 Collegiate Livestock Judging National Championship, the 15th national title for the university. Also from the Kansas Forest Service here at K-State, Jason Hartman will take a look at the recently revised Kansas Forest Plan. And later then, Jeff Wickman with this week's 4-H segment, where we'll hear about the new 4-H Club Corner. All that right here on Agriculture Today.
A social distancing tip.
While the CDC urges you to avoid close contact, like hugging or shaking hands, there are other non-physical ways to say hello. Wave, wink, use sign language, salute, smile, give the peace sign, throw up an air high five, do jazz hands. Remember, stay a minimum of 6 feet or 2 arms length away from others and stay home if you can. For more info, visit coronavirus.gov.
Let's all do our part. Because we're all hashtag alone together. Brought to you by the Ad Council.
You are tuned in to Agriculture Today. As always, it's good to have you listening in. For our cattle market segment to get this week rolling, we turn now to livestock economist Darrell Peel, Oklahoma State University, for his comments and insight. And we have a smorgasbord of things to pick up on post-Thanksgiving holiday here, Darrell. We'll do so starting with the market review for last week, with the holiday interrupting the normal flow of things to a certain extent. But the Fed cattle trade was fairly spotty nonetheless, wasn't it?
It was. I mean, the holiday shortened week changed things a little bit. And, you know, and we're getting into this holiday season, and towards the end of the year, we're going to see a lot of, you know, kind of different dynamics as we go forward. But the bottom line is this Fed cattle market seems to be holding steady more or less through this period.
And we want to spend some time on the feeder cattle market at length as well, which we'll do in just a few moments. But bring us up to speed on slaughter trends and our beef production volumes. And that will dovetail into what might be expected of beef demand going forward.
You bet. You know, on the supply side, yeah, this has been such an interesting year. Of course, we've had just enormous disruptions, especially in the first half of the year. Here in the second half of the year and continuing up to this point, we've seen beef production following, you know, pretty close to year-ago levels. Actually, we've been averaging 1.5 to 2% above year-ago levels. You know, steer slaughter has been running above last year's levels, but heifer slaughter's been running below last year's levels. And, of course, we've continued to see these carcass weights remain heavy. They appear to have peaked seasonally, but they're still very heavy. And so all of that to say that we've got more beef production here at the end of the year on a year-over-year basis. But what's really interesting is when you look at where we're projected to come out here for the whole year, despite everything that's happened, we're going to come out very, very close to what we thought we would be back in January or February when we were looking ahead to what to expect in 2020.
It really is a tribute to the industry, isn't it, in that with all the disruptions, it has managed to right the ship, more or less, through the balance of 2020, ever since the springtime anyway.
That's right. And of course, it also highlights the fact that in the cattle industry, numbers are pretty well fixed on a, you know, basically an annual basis. Coming into the year, we kind of knew how many cattle were out there. We did have some slaughter disruptions. It delayed cattle. It changed weights a little bit. But we didn't depopulate like the hog industry, unfortunately, has been forced to do. So we really didn't change the overall cattle numbers. We've just changed the timing tremendously. And that's what's made it a challenge here in the last several cattle on feed reports, trying to get a bead on how the timing is going to work. But it doesn't change the overall outcome. We're going to end up at about the same place here at some point in time.
And then we turn to the demand side domestically now. The latest on boxed beef, how's that trending at the moment?
You know, boxed beef has been, like everything else, very dynamic. You know, after Labor Day, we had some run-up before Labor Day. We dropped off after Labor Day into October, and then we've had a very strong run-up since mid-October. So in the last 5 weeks or so, a strong run-up. And for me, I'm watching how that box beef demand breaks down across the different products, because we know demand changes in the fall and winter. Different products are in demand. And you certainly see that here. And of course, the overall concern is the general level of demand, with continuing pandemic impacts on the market, with the continuing recessionary issues that we have, with all of the political turmoil about whether we'll have more stimulus or not to help support consumer spending. All of those factors are very critical as we go forward.
As a matter of fact, you recently put together an article with more in-depth perspectives on domestic beef demand, and it brings in the holiday season and our traditional trends there. The worry here is about the food service side of beef usage and beef demand, and how well that's going to bear up as we head into the holidays and with further pandemic-related restrictions, Daryl.
That's exactly right. Of course, we've seen a restricted food service component since March. It's somewhat recovered compared to the initial lockdown, but the bottom line is it remains very restricted. And as we go into the winter, we typically see more emphasis on food service consumption. Of course, we're still putting a lot of extra emphasis on the retail grocery side right now. So there's a number of things that you can see in some of these wholesale beef cut trends. Ribeyes are very, very popular for Christmas and New Year's consumption, and that's been one of the kind of key indicators I've been watching this fall to sort of see how that demand is. And actually, it's been very, very strong. We've seen the normal seasonal run-up in ribeye prices even a little bit stronger compared to a year ago. So that's a good sign, and that's probably a combination of food service demand and retail grocery. Ribeyes do move through grocery stores as well. Other products tell a little bit different story. Again, from a food service perspective, beef tenderloin is almost exclusively a restaurant menu item, and those prices are very weak, down over 20% compared to a year ago. And then we see things like chucks and rounds actually recently have picked back up again. I think that's a function of, the emphasis on retail grocery. And in fact, we've heard anecdotally that consumers, with sort of a new wave of pandemic impacts and concerns about what might happen here in the coming weeks, are sort of stocking up again. And so I think we're seeing some of that demand there. Briskets are really weak this year. They tend to be a popular barbecue restaurant item, but they're actually down because of the restrictions on that food service side. So it's a mixed bag, and it's something that we have to watch very carefully going forward to see just how this demand picture shakes out as we go through the winter.
We will track it very closely, of course. On the feeder cattle side, again, drawing from yet another article that you put together, and you have described the feeder market as dynamic. Likewise, to what extent? What brings you to that description?
Well, it's always true, of course. Anytime we look at the feeder cattle market and we look at the prices for, the range of weights of feeder cattle that are going through the market at any point in time, you've really got a mix of things there. On the lightweight side, you've got calves, typically sort of new crop animals, if you will. On the heavyweight end, you've all got a lot of yearling cattle. And that's particularly pronounced in the fall of the year when we are marketing a lot of our newly weaned calves. And so what we've seen, at least the Oklahoma auction prices bear out, that we've seen a very pronounced difference between the light half of that, the lightweight half of that, and the heavyweight half of that. And after we had the early winter storm in late October, we saw demand for stocker cattle, for winter grazing, pick up. And so we've seen a significant increase in those calf prices, the calf and lightweight feeder cattle. On the heavyweight side, basically no change in that market, and prices are pretty flat from about 600 pounds up for steers, where there's almost no change in price, no rollback that's typically there. And so, and that kind of reflects the fact that we've got higher feed costs sort of weighing on these markets. And again, we're trying to deal with the sort of changing dynamics of the cattle supply that's available at this time of the year. So what you get is something that happens to some extent every year, perhaps a little more pronounced this year. It's sort of the tale of two different feeder cattle markets, depending on which half of that market you look at, from the lightweight animal side to the heavyweight animal side.
A couple of quick questions aligned with all of that then. What about producers who are still holding those calves post-weaning, still on the fence as to whether or not to take advantage of the market? What is the market saying to those producers?
Well, certainly with the increase we've seen in these prices for lightweight calves, if you have held off to this point in time, but you typically would be thinking about selling these calves, the opportunity's there. We've actually seen a nice run-up in the last 3 weeks or so in these calf prices. And so, you know, that's an opportunity that certainly wasn't there in October, and I would think about that. The question of maybe backgrounding, retaining those calves and backgrounding them, which would be the same essential decision that a stocker producer might be looking at for winter grazing, is one that's been extremely dynamic. And so futures markets have been very volatile. The cash markets on the front end have been very volatile. And so the answer to that just depends on what you evaluate at a point in time and where you're at, of course, with your production possibilities to maintain those calves, what feed resources you might have available. So the answer here is that you have to figure it out at every point in time, and it's been very volatile this fall, which is makes it a challenge to make any sort of kind of blanket recommendation.
Right. And as to wheat pasture, is the demand for calves for stocking wheat about at an end, or will we see a resurgence there, given in particular the moisture that graced a lot of the Central Plains this past week?
I suspect that a lot of the demand is in that market with the improved prospects that we got from the moisture that you refer to. You know, I think we have seen an increase in demand, but I suspect a lot of that's in place at this point. And the underlying concern is that even with the moisture, which certainly helps us get the fall growth that we need on wheat pasture, but underneath it all, there's still a lot of dry conditions around, and there's a recognition that, you know, we may run out at some point if we don't get additional moisture. And, of course, it depends on how the weather plays out as well. So I suspect we've probably got most of the wheat pasture demand in place at this point in time, and we're going to kind of move forward with what we have and see how things play out for the rest of the winter.
Well, Darrell, your take on the market's always appreciated. We will catch up with you again quite soon. Many thanks to you.
You're very welcome.
He is out of Oklahoma State University. Livestock economist Darrell Peel with us on the cattle markets. You are tuned in to Agriculture Today. After this break, a conversation with the coach and a couple of members of K-State's national champion livestock judging team. As they brought home that coveted hardware just a few days back, they're standing by to visit with us here on the K-State Radio Network.
What is radon? Home exposure to radon gas is the leading cause of lung cancer death in the United States for non-smokers. In Kansas, one in four homes will test at or above the EPA action level. The Surgeon General recommends all homes be tested and fixed if necessary. Visit KansasRadonProgram.org for more information. Test, fix, save a life. This message brought to you by the Kansas Radon Program, the Kansas Association of Broadcasters, and this station.
Welcome back. You're listening to Agriculture Today. A big achievement out of the Animal Sciences and Industry Department at K-State here in the last several days, and you probably heard about it. Kansas State University's livestock judging team came away with the national championship for 2020. Along with us here is the coach of that team, an animal scientist at K-State, Chris Mullenix. Two of the current members of the team, they are from Kansas, as a matter of fact, Chisholm Grund from Sharon Springs and Trace Mulligan of Scott City. And with them as well is Peyton Dahmer, who is the assistant coach, a graduate student at K-State, and a former livestock judging team member. So, Chris, congratulations to you and this group. Something that's been on the cusp for the last several years, and now you've broken through.
Yeah, Eric, it's really exciting, and what an honor it is for a group of students that have worked their whole lives in many cases to get to this point. And many of your listeners know, as a member of a livestock judging team at a collegiate level, you get one calendar year shot at this deal. It's not like football or basketball where they show up to K-State and they're a member of this team for 4 years and keep getting to try again. They get one run at it. It's a great part of this event, but it's a lot of pressure sometimes. And as you said, K-State's had an amazing history of livestock judging, but this was the first time since 1998 that we came home with that national championship. And many people don't realize in that time frame between from 99 until last year, a 20-year time frame there, we had 11 reserve national champion teams, many of which lost by single-digit scores. So it wasn't that we ever necessarily had a downgrade in our level of competition or our abilities as a department or as a team, sometimes it takes a little bit of luck, too. And, you know, what I will tell you with this particular crew, they took luck out of the equation most of the time. And they won our national contest by in excess of a 60-point margin. That's a pretty dominant performance. And we were excited to bring that Bronze Bull. That's kind of the crowning award that comes with the national championship. And we were proud to bring it back to Manhattan where we feel like it looks right at home.
And K-State is awfully proud of you and this whole crew. And before we talk with a few of the members here and your assistant coach as well, you might go through the path to the national championship. This is a series of contests that build up those points.
We have, as I mentioned earlier, we judge for one calendar year, and our first major competition of the year is at the National Western Stock Show in Denver annually. We started at Denver in January with this crew, and we work through a spring semester where we attend about half a dozen different competitions where they gain incredibly valuable experience competing against all of the biggest competitors from across the country. And then that culminates here in the fall to our last two major competitions, the American Royal, which was about a month ago in Kansas City, and then our national championship. And all of those are important to us. But I will say one thing, that it's a little like a basketball team entering the NCAA tournament. It almost doesn't matter what you did prior to it if you don't show up at the last one. You know, that's why it is so important that these young people are on their game every time we step out there, but especially at Louisville in that final event, because that's the one that brings home the big hardware. So they were absolutely ready for it. But the neat thing about this group was the consistency and dominance that they had all year. And then, you know, we won the last five all-species contests that we competed in. I don't know if it had ever happened before, but this team was the high team in oral reasons at every single contest they ever went to, and had a remarkable feat in putting all five team members in the top 10 in oral reasons at our national championship, which I had never seen done before. It's pretty cool.
It is indeed. Let's bring in the team members and have them talk about the experience. And both of these young fellas are from Western Kansas. Chisholm from Sharon Springs, how did you get started in livestock judging, and what drew you to the team?
Actually, there's a pretty rich history of livestock judging in our family, and I grew up on a cow-calf operation where we raised seed stock cattle for producers across the country. We primarily raise Galvey balancers, and we have a few Angus and Red Angus too. So we got started just the passion for agriculture, and then there's been a rich history with my dad. He was on the livestock judging team here, and then also my brother, and then I guess I followed him up. So that's how I got started with the livestock judging deal and brought me to Kansas State.
How about you, Trace?
Well, my story is a little bit different than Chisholm's. My parents, I guess, necessarily didn't really grow up on a farm, per se. My dad had a couple horses and was kind of into the horse showing thing whenever he grew up. And then they kind of took a job in town, and so we didn't grow up on a farm initially. And then whenever I started getting into 4-H and FFA, we had a lot of really good family friends that kind of got us involved in that, and then so we decided that we were going to move out to a farm, and so we got really involved with raising show pigs and exhibiting other species of livestock, and then that kind of just led me to livestock judging. I started probably whenever I was 10 or 12, or I don't really remember exactly, and so that just kind of led me to junior college, where I judged with Chisholm out there at Hutchinson Community College, and then we both knew, just growing up in Kansas and with the rich history that K-State had, that this was going to be our home and this is where we wanted to be. And so that's what led us here to K-State.
Well, Chisholm and Trace, just summarize what this whole activity has meant to you and what the success that you've achieved now has brought to you personally.
Well, I think, like Chris stated, I think it's just awesome to be part of such a dominant team and the success we had. But I think something that's even more important to me, and I think I can speak for the rest of our team members and our coaches when I say this, that the friendships and just the connections we make in the industry and traveling to different places and seeing different seed stock and livestock across the country is something, and meeting those producers and seeing that is something that's really special to all of us.
Yeah, no, I mean, I really agree with that, with what Chisholm said. And from the very beginning, this was kind of a pretty special team to be on, and we could just tell with everyone that we were around, you know, we all loved this, and we all wanted to be here, and we all had one goal in mind, and that was, you know, to hopefully be national champions by the time our judging career ended. We had so much faith in each other, which made it really unique, is whenever we went out there to Louisville for the national contest, every one of us knew that we didn't have to be the high individual. We didn't have to go out there and win the contest individually. And we just all had to go out there and do what we had learned to do what we love to do out there. And so that just made it really fun and made it a pretty easy day, honestly, going in there knowing that you're going to be backed by a group of extremely talented kids that if you had a bad day, hopefully all the other four kids would probably have a great day. And so it really kind of took the pressure off of things, and we could just go out there and enjoy the day and enjoy our last contest that we went to, and we were really fortunate enough to come out on top.
Peyton, if you'd contribute, you, the assistant coach, but not that far removed from being a team member yourself, your role here was something of an intermediary?
Yeah, so like you mentioned, I was a part of the K-State Livestock Judging Program and judged in the national contest just 2 short years ago. And in that contest, our team fell shy just a few points of achieving that goal. And so having the opportunity to stay on as a graduate student in the Department of Animal Science and work with Chris as an assistant coach for him, kind of I still had that thirst to want to get the national championship. And so being a part of the last two teams, still wanted to achieve that goal. And just to echo what these guys said, it was really a great day because their hard work had paid off. And it was a great experience for me to work with them. And the team that I was able to coach last year, I've been able to learn from Chris as a mentor about this whole coaching thing. But it's really been great to form those relationships with the students on the teams the last couple years. They're folks that I consider great friends, and they're great livestock enthusiasts and livestock minds. So it's really rewarding for me to see their goals be accomplished here in the end as well.
Chris, this is a fine group of young people, obviously, and you're extraordinarily proud of them and their accomplishment, and that's what makes it all rewarding, isn't it?
Without a doubt. And I've had several people, you know, in the last few days that even have asked me questions, you know, what do you think was the difference? I think we all knew something was special when we got started, and I know it's maybe cliche to kind of say that, but this is one of those teams where I just tried to not say too much because my expectations were so high. And I think we all felt that way and felt like if we just continued to improve that we were going to be in a great place.
It all fell together and resulted in the high achievement of national champion. Congratulations to you and to the team, Chris, and the best of luck to all of you moving forward. Appreciate your time, Ray.
Thanks.
And once again, Chris Mullenix, animal scientist at K-State, the coach of the K-State livestock judging team. The assistant is Peyton Dahmer. Also with us, Chisholm Grund from Sharon Springs and Trace Mulligan of Scott City, two of the members, helping the team capture that North American International Livestock Exposition title just a few days back in Louisville. And with that 15th national championship for Kansas State University's program. Take just a quick couple of moments here to mention the remaining team members: Skyler Scotton, Daniel Dobbs, Austin Visselmeyer, Cagney Effling, Justin Slayball. Also on the team, Madison Andre, Lane Egger, and Sam Gleason. And congratulations to all of them as well. We'll be back with more on Agriculture Today.
Did you know every Kansas farmer feeds 128 plus people?
Kansas farmers are hard workers, dependable, authentic, and sensitive.
Not only do farmers put food on your table, but they put clothes on your back and fuel in your car.
For more information about Kansas farmers, visit K-State Research and Extension online or stop by your local Extension office. This message has been brought to you by the K-State Animal Sciences Leadership Academy participants.
We're back now on this Agriculture Today. Word just came out a few days back from the Kansas Forest Service here at Kansas State University that those interested in managing our forest resources in the state have just put together the updated version of what's called the Kansas Forest Action Plan. Now, this has relevance to you landowners, as we'll pass along to you now. We've brought by the state forester who oversees the service, Jason Hartman. So background on this, Jason, this
plan, and this process has been in place for a time, right?
Yes, it has, Eric. Thanks for having me over. The U.S. Forest Service, who oversees a lot of our funding and activities here in the state, as we partner with them to deliver forest expertise and forest technical service, they came up with this process to guide the actions of state forestry agencies through a process of assessment and strategy. So assessing the condition of the forest resources and then coming up with a strategy to manage those resources with the limited resources that are available to do that management.
And this is routinely revised every, what, 5 years or so?
Yeah, the first iteration came in 2010. Updated with a kind of a light update in 2015. And then this 2020 update was a little more in-depth. We kind of went through more of a fine-tuned comb, if you will, through the whole document and made more substantive changes this time.
What is the process? How does the Forest Service go about identifying the existing needs of the day?
Well, like I said, we need to do an assessment first of what the current condition is. Mm-hmm. And that comes, as all stages in the process, it is both collaborative, and we use the best science available, and we use our knowledge of our own staff, of course. So we gathered all the data from many sources, a lot of it just the boots on the ground of our own staff, the forest inventory analysis data, data from our partner agencies like Wildlife and Parks and Tourism, here in Kansas, NRCS at the national level, U.S. Forest Service. So gathered every data we can get our hands on for that assessment piece to just see what the condition is right now. Are we gaining in quality and quantity of forest resources? Are we declining? Where are the largest threats and where are the greatest opportunities? And then we turn that assessment into, okay, that's where we stand now. Where would we like to make sure we keep the good things going, and where would we like to take the opportunity to address risks and to improve on what we've assessed?
And in this context, when we're talking about forest resources, largely trees, of course, but exclusively so, or is it more of the forest ecosystem?
Good question. We did, through this process, we touched on, everything the agency touches on, everything from what we consider traditional rural forestry to timbered stands of forest that meet the forest definition, to windbreaks, shelter belts, urban and community forestry, timber products, forest health issues from invasive species, insects, disease, and as well as wildland fire issues. So we touched on everything that the agency touches on with this plan.
Well, then, let's dig into that plan and its latest edition, if we might. You say that you and colleagues, everybody contributing to this, came up with 7 forest resource issues.
Right. And those are either, like I said, opportunities or risks that needed to be addressed. One is this, the wildfire risk. We needed to make sure we're looking at where are the fires occurring, where are they the most threatened to infrastructure and structures, where do we need to increase training, equipment, things like that. We looked at that. Where could we do fuels treatments? So that's the first one. Loss of Kansas forest land. So where are we either to development, to disease, to natural disasters? Where are we losing that resource? And where can we either halt that or reverse it? Water quality and quantity, sustaining that through work in riparian buffers, the health of existing riparian forests. Fourth one was looking at, the habitat out there, the biodiversity, making sure that is maintained and enhanced. We also looked at sustaining and protecting forest and agroforestry systems, making sure we have the service, the assistance, and the resources to protect those in perpetuity as we go through generational changes. And lastly, maintaining and protecting economic benefits. So those that are managing their woodlands for a eventual output on the other end, making sure there are viable markets available for that.
These priorities have been identified. What happens then as far as the implementation of this plan? Is there a timeline that you follow with it? How does it work, Jason?
The intent is there aren't timelines really in the plan. It is kind of a continual assessment that we are meeting the guidelines of the plan through everything we do day to day, month to month, year to year from here forward.
This will help, though, you and those who implement various programs in support of forest resources in Kansas, prioritize and target efforts based on the need? Is that the value of this plan, Jason?
It is. It is definitely one of the big benefits. You know, we wish we had all the staff and finances that we could just do everything that needs to be done that we assessed as a need, but that's not the case. So this does help us to, through a collaborative partnership, science-based approach, to make sure we are meeting the risks and opportunities that have the greatest need or have the greatest potential benefit with the limited resources we have available to do that.
Well, if one would like to get a glance at the plan and its details, is it out there for public view somewhere?
It will be. We will getting some limited print copies to our partners, but the general public, the online, the digital version that is available at our kansasforest.org website would be the best location to find that.
Once more, a process that is vital to continued support and conservation of our forest resources here in Kansas. It is the Forest Action Plan for the state. The latest version of it was just released out of the Kansas Forest Service. A nod to you and your colleagues for pulling this together, Jason. Thanks for going over it with us today.
Well, thanks for having us, and we would be remiss if we didn't mention that the KSRE was a great help in getting the plan done, help us to explain it to the public here with this opportunity, as well as we had great editing and assistance as well from KSRE.
That's Jason Hartman. Jason is the state forester for Kansas out of the Kansas Forest Service here at Kansas State University. Again, if you'd like to learn more about or see firsthand the latest Kansas Forest Action Plan, go to kansasforests.org. After this break, Jeff Wickman with this week's 4-H segment for you here on Agriculture Today.
Eat today? Thank a farmer. A way to get more involved in agriculture is through 4-H and FFA. Through 4-H and FFA, we have been given multiple opportunities to grow as leaders and learn more about agriculture.
You can learn skills related to jobs, public speaking skills, and you get the opportunity to travel around the country and meet new people.
If you want more information about getting more involved in 4-H and FFA, visit them on their websites at kansasffa.org and kansas4h.org.
Welcome back, and thanks for joining us on Agriculture Today. I'm Jeff Wickman. Kansas 4-H has a new 4-H Club Corner, an online resource to support club leaders. Kansas 4-H Youth Development Specialist for the Northeast Region, Diane Mack, and Tristan Cope, the 4-H Youth Development Agent for the Chisholm Trail District, join us to discuss the tools and resources available in the 4-H Club Corner. Diane, the pandemic has brought on a lot of changes. 4-H is really at the forefront of some of these changes when it comes to doing their meetings. They had to go from in-person to virtual, and as part of that, you set up a task force to find out how to do it better.
Yes, we certainly did. And so to help our club and project leaders, a task force was formed. And what we wanted to do was to arm them with some new resources to help engage our 4-H members and the families in that virtual setting.
One of the things that you're really finding out is that you need some help in ways to make the youth thrive.
Yeah, so we have looked at the research done by Dr. Mary Arnold, and she's a 4-H youth development specialist from Oregon, and she's developed a thriving model. And so when she looks at how we can help youth continue to thrive and move forward during these times, there's four different things that she says we need to focus on. And one of those things is that sense of connection or belonging. And it's just creating, in a virtual setting, that safe and inclusive environment that involves all and, you know, focuses on their well-being. The second important piece is to focus on youth sparks. And what those are interests that the young person has, those passions. And with 4-H, we think of those different projects, whether it's photography, whether it's their beef project. And what they can do during this time is to really focus on learning and developing skills within these sparks or projects. The third thing is to continue those developmental relationships. And we know that those have always been so key to 4-H work, that young people know that they have ongoing and supportive, caring connections with other youth and with adults who will help them to empower them. And then also they all work together to contribute to their community. And the fourth then is to continue that youth voice. Many times during the pandemic, we feel like we don't have any control. And so it's so important that the youth still feel that they can be engaged, that they can provide input, and that they can have those skills that they can contribute not only to the 4-H program, but to their community as well.
Tristan, was this research something that you took into account as a member of the task force as you put together all of these various resources and tools?
Yes, we definitely tried to keep the Thrive model from Dr. Mary Arnold in mind when we were planning out each of the different resources that we made.
I think you have about a dozen different tools and resources. Do you want to cover some of those and maybe why you felt they were important to be included on this Club Corner?
Yes. One of my favorite resources that we made was the 4-H Leaders Toolbox. This 4-H Leaders Toolbox is a great document to help leaders prepare for any of their upcoming meetings. It has links to your local, your state, and your national resources on there. It also contains some helpful resources for your virtual meetings, which we know is a huge component that was really highlighted during our Kansas Engagement Club survey. This is something that is a great way for you to find resources on Zoom, Kahoot, the polling features, Flipgrid, all of those really robust and great resources for your virtual formats. I also like to look at the new family guides that we have. We have a new family guide and a 4-H greet sheet that is perfect for those new club members joining. On the 4-H greet sheet, it is great because it kind of gives you what to expect when you go to a club meeting. We have something called the Club Weaning Wheel, and this is going to be broken down into each of the areas that you can see during a club meeting and what you might talk about. Another one is at the meetings. What can you expect when you're at a meeting? How do you put a meeting together is another question that we get from club leaders. We actually created a great template that you can use for clubs to fill out and then to take it back to their club and then present their meeting. Another one that we have is part of a meeting reflection. This is a great way if you're not able to go to visit other clubs to do a survey. This is a great one that you can use internally to kind of assess and reflect on how your club is going. It gives the youth a way to reflect on their own meetings and lets them have that voice. The last one that we really focused on was some of those foundational resources. We really wanted to make sure that we supported the club leaders with ways that we can enhance their programming, as well as what is programming when you're looking at the Kansas 4-H. So we made sure to include in here the Kansas 4-H learning pathway and how a project can be more than just a fair entry.
Diane, how does all of this fit in then with the overall focus of 4-H in terms of really engaging the youth? I know it's a different mechanism when we're doing the virtual, but it sounds like you found a way to make that connection.
Yes, and as Tristan mentioned the club engagement survey. And so what we did learn from our club leaders when we asked, you know, they said, you know, we just need ideas to help continue to foster that connection and belonging within our club members. And so it was really imperative that we kind of put some of those thoughts together and the tools, you know, try this within the meeting. And if that doesn't quite work, then maybe try this. And so we just really appreciate the work that our club leaders have done and continue to do. And, you know, some of them are now meeting face-to-face. Some are kind of in a hybrid mode, and some are still meeting virtually.
Well, the important thing here is we have remained connected to the 4-H youth, and we probably are learning a lot of things that we maybe wouldn't have otherwise learned without this pandemic.
You know, that's so true. I've just seen such innovation from the extension agents and their programming to help young people to continue to thrive, as Dr. Arnold says, during these times. And so even at the state level, many of our events have gone virtually, and young people still had a voice in what that looked like, you know, with our different conferences that we've had. And Tristan's been able to see that locally as well.
Well, and what a great resource and what a comfort it must be to the leaders to have the opportunity to get some ideas and maybe feel a little bit more confident as they move forward.
Yes, and so we encourage all club and project leaders to go to the Kansas 4-H website and click on that club corner just to see those resources and what might be helpful to them.
And we have recently had several trainings across Kansas for our new officers as well as our club leaders, and it has been great to be able to showcase these different documents and the support that they can have from our 4-H office.
That's Tristan Cope, the 4-H Youth Development Agent for the Chisholm Trail District, and Diane Mack, the Kansas 4-H Youth Development Specialist for the Northeast Region, with an update on the new 4-H Club Corner. In addition to the Kansas 4-H website, more information can be found at county and district extension offices. And that'll do it for this edition of Agriculture Today. For Eric Atkinson, I'm Jeff Wickman. This is the K-State Radio Network.